In December 2002, Japan saw the release of a GameCube port of Skies of Arcadia, titled Skies of Arcadia Legends, to distinguish it from the previous release, as the new version had a number of alterations and added content. The North American release followed in January, with Europe then getting the game in May. This updated re-release fixed several issues with the original game, including updating the models to have actual fingers and fixing the absolutely ridiculous encounter rate. Experience and gold drops were adjusted to compensate. Of course, it wasn't all good news. The GameCube version has some clipping issues due to a less efficient buffer than the Dreamcast, and the sound is widely known to be far less good. The Dreamcast version used a sound engine called Cybersound, but this wasn't used on the GameCube, leading to effects not being applied, instruments tailing off at inappropriate times, and an overall sparseness of sound. For a game that had such an amazing soundtrack, this was not a good look. Most important, of course, was the added content. Three side quests were added to the game, while Pinta's quest was removed, for the same reason we never did it in the LP, no access to the VMU. Aside from the side quests, an entire set of special ranks were added to the swashbuckler system, and Vyse the Legend became a marker of what's basically 100% completion, rather than simply the highest rank on the chart. There were also 24 new discoveries added, for a total of 88. There's an 89th, but it doesn't count toward Domingo's title, and can only be gotten after getting Vyse the Legend rank. And of course, the DLC content was packaged with the game from the beginning, including the 30th Cham and Hamacho Island, that place above the Dark Rift I was looking for, where an old hermit in a bird costume will tell you all about your stats. No, I don't know why either. So, those swashbuckler rankings. There are 7 rankings in between King of Rogues and Legend, each one gained not by standard swashbuckler choices and behavior, but by filling special requirements. Higher-ranked ones will supersede lower ranks, even if you get the higher rank first. In order, they are Vyse the Charismatic, recruit all 22 crew members. Vyse the Extravagant, have 1 million gold and the following items: an enhanced kitchen, which you can buy in Nasrad, a floor heater, which you can buy from the black market ship in Ixataka, an air purifier, which is a drop from the Alania with Khalifa as your merchant, a Yafutoman alcove, which you can buy in Yafutoma, soundproofing, that is dropped by the Raja if you have Khalifa in your crew. It will actually be called Crystal Ball? A chandelier, which you can buy in Crescent Isle, and a wooden doll, which is dropped by the Rock with Khalifa in your crew. We saw that. Then there is Vyse the Battle Lord. Kill at least 2,500 enemies total. Then we have Vyse the Fisher King. Catch 1,000 fish. Yeah, obviously I would not have done so well on that. Sky Battle King Vyse. Kill the 4 monsters, the Rock, the Obispo, the Alania, and the Giant Looper, which was DLC for us, and win 12 other non-story ship battles. Exploration King Vyse. Find all 88 discoveries, which requires completing a side quest, and obtain at least 90% of all treasures. Vyse the Bounty King. Complete and report all 8 bounty battles. We'll talk about those in a second. To get the rank of Vyse the Legend? Hoo boy. The requirements for that are actually mostly fulfilled by previous ranks. You need to make all 88 discoveries, find 100% of all treasures, which is a problem because the number of one-time dungeons in this game means that some stuff is going to become unavailable eventually. Complete and report all 8 bounty battles. This is one of the new side quests. Complete the Angel of Death side quest. We'll talk about that one too. Oh, and completing it requires completing the 3rd side quest, or nearly anyway. Recruit all 22 crew members, kill at least 2,500 enemies in total, and defeat all 4 giant monsters and win 12 other non-story ship battles. I suggest grinding Valuan Mage ships right after you get Fina back. On top of all this, there is a new rank you get as soon as you get the World is Round on your discovery list, assuming you're already up to Vyse the Daring. Vyse the Fallen Pirate. This doesn't actually affect your swashbuckler rating, except that suddenly the shopkeepers and guildmasters don't like you anymore. But it ties into the first of the 3 side quests added for this game, the bounty list. You remember those wanted posters we kept seeing and how there was one for us eventually? Well, in Legends, we can now hunt down black pirates, for which guildmasters will give us money. There are 8 battles in all. The first is Baltor the Blackbearded. Yeah, it's this dude. He's the only one of these we fight in ship-to-ship combat, and I'm fairly sure, yes, his bounty fight is required by the story. Rupee of the Larso clan is the second, a little kid who had to take over as the head of a black pirate clan and his hulking bodyguard. When you beat them up, they give up and go sell carpets. 3 is Gordo the Round, the other mandatory bounty fight in the game. You know how this battle goes, and goes, and goes, and goes. Number 4 is Loose Cannon Loppin. He's one of Senteam's adopted kids gone bad. Kicking his ass makes him admit he's not nearly the engineer his father is. Number 5 is the Ixoness Demons. Remember the Ixoness Village? Yeah, these three ladies are from it, kidnapping men they think are worthy. They all have a thing for Vyse, to Ika's annoyance. Number 6, Vyse the Legend. Wait, what? Yeah, this is why everybody's calling us Fallen Pirate when we get back. These assholes decided to capitalize on their resemblance to us and rob people. Vyse, Anita, and Fina are their names, or in the Japanese, they're Baisu, Anita, and Fiera. Kicking their ass gets our swashbuckler rating back on track and makes them realize they ought to be on the stage. There's one leaving in 5 minutes. Vyse also drops us the Tuna Cutlass, and Anita drops the Swirl Meringue, the two joke weapons that were DLC in the original Dreamcast version. Daikokuya the Wealthy is number 7. A Yafutomen-era pirate who looks like a Funko Pop rides on a mechanized Maneki Neko called Tama and is the wealthiest man in Yafutoma. This guy mostly summons bodyguards or throws money at you. And hits on Vyse. Okay then. And last but not least is number 8, Lord Zivelin Bane. Yeah, this guy's the head of the clan and will be waiting in Soltis, along with a regular Zivelin Bane, for you to go after the Orb of Serenity. Seriously, dude, the world is ending. Don't you have anything better to do? Which brings us to the last two side quests in the game, which I've already briefly alluded to when talking about Ramirez. These two side quests are the Angel of Death, which is basically a series of optional boss fights that you can have jump you at various points in the story, and the Moonfish Hunt. Moonfish in Legends are not just the high-altitude jellyfish that we caught several of. They're also a weird fish thing that can be found hidden in towns and caves all over Arcadia, though never in one-time dungeons. A man named Doc can be found on a ship near Sailor's Island. He'll give you something that allows you to collect moonfish to feed to Piccolo, the pet hamacho of Maria, the little girl he's caring for. Each time you feed the bird a fish, he'll spit out an item for you. No word on why he's eating these things, or if you have to clean bird saliva off of them. When you have retrieved 23 of the 24 moonfish, Maria will speak again, and Doc will tell you about how Maria is the younger daughter of Admiral Mendoza, and will explain the bit of Ramirez's history that I talked about earlier in the LP. It also unlocks the last of the 4 battles in the Angel of Death side quest. The first 3 are unlocked by talking to a guildmaster at certain points in the game and picking up a black spot item. Why is that? Because Piastol, the Angel of Death, is the older daughter of Admiral Mendoza, who awoke to find her ship on fire and boarded by blue rogues. Being 10, she immediately decided they were the culprits and has sworn to kill all pirates, as she sees no difference between black pirates and blue rogues. Oh yeah, and she tossed a knife at Ika back then, but Vyse knocked her out of the way and now has a scar on his cheek from said knife. You get the feeling they wanted to put a lot of this stuff into the game from the beginning, but ran out of room or time? Beating the crap out of Piastol for the 4th and final time has you convince her to go find her little sister. Delivering the final moonfish to Doc then reveals that she did so, even though she didn't tell Maria of her identity just yet. Once the final fish is fed to Piccolo, the Hamacho will evolve into the final discovery, the Moon Hamacho, and fly off for home, leaving Maria behind. But she's happier because she knows Piccolo can be with his friends. Aww. At this point, if you have achieved the rank of Vyse the Legend, you can now find the 3 secrets, the last bit of new content this game has. The first is the Golden Hamacho. This is treated as a discovery, and it's found sitting on the stone arch that leads from mid-ocean to Sailor's Island. It doesn't go in your log or count toward your total, though, so call it a pseudo-discovery. Then there's the Sky Fang, a weapon for Vyse more uber than the Vorlich Blade. Remember, you have to have beaten Lord Zivelin Bane for this, buried deep in Soltis, so at this point you did at least get your money's worth from that thing. The Sky Fang can be bought from the Mystery Merchant. And last, there is an optional boss fight. Returning to Crescent Island, you will be jumped by none other than Vigoro, who is now a blue rogue, and still a creepy rapist. It's basically an upgraded version of the fight on Dangrel Island. So, is Legends worth it? Well, honestly, that's a loaded question. Getting a Dreamcast, and moreover one that still works, is difficult at best. The hardware was not the most robust, and we've seen the problems with emulation. The GameCube port is easier to find and has all the extra content. It has its issues, but the clipping is probably less distracting than the crap we've had to put up with in this LP, so the sound is really the make or break. To be perfectly frank, as I think more people should experience this amazing game, yes, get your hands on Legends if you can. Because maybe if we all agitate enough, they'll fix the sound and port the whole thing to the Switch. What? A penguin can dream, can't she? Anyway, thank you guys for sticking with me on this roller coaster ride. I don't know when I'll be back, but I'll keep you informed. Have a great evening. Goodbye.